Okay, so the last part will be dedicated to Brillouin scattering in tapered single mode fiber. So it's not standard single mode fiber, it's just taper to obtain very small diameter. So how we produce this? We use a standard single mode fiber with a diameter of 125 micrometer, and we taper with different technique, flame, CO2 laser, etc. And you can create a very long or not, but you can create a very thin silica rod. So you see here it's a silica rod of 500 nanometers, and just here around one hair. So here I will present you tapered optical fiber associated with chalcogenide glasses. Chalcogenide glasses is really interesting for optics because chalcogenide present a very large nonlinear coefficient and a really large transmission window, larger than I think 4 or 5 micrometer. So it's interesting to create optical sources in the mid infrared, and also present a very large Kerr coefficient. So it's for nonlinear optics, large Brillouin gain, 200 larger than silica. So it's nice for Brillouin scattering, and really interesting also for lasing application. So for this we're working with McGill University in Montreal. So in McGill, Professor Martin Rochette fabricated a microwire in chalcogenide. So here in white, this is single mode fiber, standard telecom fiber, so two piece here, and here this is the chalcogenide microwire. So you see here this part, this is equivalent to this section. So this is a decrease of the diameter because here it's a large part and a very small part. And here the diameter of chalcogenide, it's 1 micrometer. So this is a picture. So you have the single mode fiber here in white, the chalcogenide. So this is a chemical definition of the chalcogenide while used. Okay, so the chalcogenide is surrounded by a PMMA coating. It's really important. So the PMMA we didn't see because it's transparent, but we see here, okay, the microwire. So the PMMA coating diameter, it's 15 micrometers. The diameter of chalcogenide depends on the sample, but varying from 700 nanometers to 1 micrometers. The length, it's around 30 centimeters. So this is the core, the refractive index, you see 2.81. So as you remember, the Brillouin gain depends on the factor 7 of the refractive index, so it's really nice. The cladding, the refractive index is 1.35. And the total losses, it's only 5 or 6 dB at telecommunication wavelength. So it's really, really nice. So the polymer clothing, so the PMMA, prevents damage from the outside environment. So it's important because chalcogenide, it's really sensitive to pollution, to many pollution, etc. So this protection is really important, and with this cladding, this sample arrive by flight to very simply. So here's a macro wire, it's just butt coupling with single mode fiber, so just like this, and a UV epoxy. So now on experiment. Again, it's really simple experiment. So again, a DFB laser. So it's a very current laser, a line width below than 100 kilohertz. We inject a pump. We inject a pump, and we observe the bit between backscattering signal. So it's a Brillouin signal, and the small part of the pump in electrical domain. Okay, this is a photodiode amplifier in electrical domain. What is really interesting here for us, we have no amplification of the light. So we generate Brillouin scattering in this microwire with only 1 milliwatt of laser. So maybe with this pointer. So it's really nice. So we have different Brillouin spectrum for different diameter of the wire. So here you see a very large chalcogenide wire, so 15 micrometer, 1 micrometer, 0.9, 0.7. The shift is directly related to the refractive index or effective index of the fundamental mode. So with very broadening variation, so it's nice, but we have a problem. Because when we discuss with my colleague from McGill, the idea is, okay, we take very nonlinear waveguide with very small diameter, we can probably increase the Brillouin threshold and Brillouin interaction. So all spectra are obtained with the same input power here. And you see when we decrease the diameter, we decrease the Brillouin efficiency. So it's not really good. We would like this. And when we use a very small diameter, 0.6 micrometer, the Brillouin disappears. So we don't know why, but we're working on that. And you see here the spectral broadening is directly related to the elastic losses. Okay. So the PMMA, the Brillouin land width in the PMMA, is 120 megahertz. And the idea is that the PMMA coating plays the role of an acoustic damper for the longitudinal acoustic wave involved in the Brillouin process. So to verify this assertion, we go to simulation again, so with our model. So we consider two cases, large core, 10 micrometer, chalcogenide, surrounded by polymer. Here, small core, 1 micrometer, chalcogenide, surrounded again by polymer. This is optical power density, so obtained with a COMSOL, so it's a finite element calculation, really easy. So you see here we have an effective index of 2.8, and here 2.59. So here we have a small evanescent field here. Now this is a kinetic energy of the main elastic resonance. So for a large core, you see it's really confined in the chalcogenide macrowire. Anyway, here we have some oscillation because it's a really small core. And now we just plot here the X profile, okay, of these two calculation. So in black, this is the optical power distribution, and in red, this is the elastic energy distribution. So you see for the large core, the elastic wave didn't see the PMMA. Can see like that, but for very small core, you see here the elastic energy distribution. We have a small part here of elastic energy in the PMMA. So we have the strong viscosity difference between the cladding and the core, so between the PMMA and the chalcogenide, induced losses. So again, like in photonic crystal fiber, the guidance is not provided by the refractive index difference. And as a function of diameter and cladding materials, Brillouin scattering can be enhanced or reduced. So if you change the cladding with other materials, so we're working actually to put another chalcogenide with different refractive index to increase the Brillouin sensitivity. So the last part is dedicated to tempered silica optical fibers. Silica optical fiber is nice because here we have no cladding. We have just a silica rod suspended in air. So here you see, for example, an example of a fabrication. We take standard fiber and we pull with a flame, and we can fabricate different tempered fiber with different diameters. So we define different region, so single mode fibers, a transition. Okay, and here the homogeneous section called nanofiber or macrowire, as you want. So this is the evolution of the fundamental optical mode along the fiber. So here this is this fiber. Okay, you see a very large region. So the light propagates here. When you will reduce the transition, the core disappears. Okay, so the light is guiding by the external diameter, so it's really multimode interaction. And now if you reduce the diameter, we can also obtain monomode propagation. So this is the effective refractive index as a function of macrowire diameter for silica case. It's just a calculation, very basic calculation. This is a fundamental mode. So if you fabricate a tapered silica fiber down than 1.2 micrometer, you obtain a monomode propagation, and you have a larger diameter, you have different optical mode. So this sample is really interesting for evanescent field, because if you use a very small diameter, you have a large part of the light around the fiber. Okay, so we can use for a resonator, for sensing, etc. We can also have a high confinement of the light, so for particle trapping, for example, for quantum metrology, or for continuum generation, for laser in industry. You can also use a mode converter by using this this map. And here we just working on Brillouin scattering, so we are interesting about photon and phonon, so elastic wave in rod. We have different family, so longitudinal wave, torsional wave, and radial wave. So longitudinal wave working in backward Brillouin scattering configuration, 11 GHz. Torsional wave, so it's a forward scattering around the frequency around 1 GHz. And it exists another wave, it's a surface acoustic wave, or Rayleigh waves. So a standard fiber doesn't exist, because fiber is too large. But it exists, for example, in a silica resonator. So this is a taper here. We inject the light, we generate surface acoustic wave in this sphere, and we observe here the transmitted light, and here this is anti-Stokes photons, so the frequency between the two optical waves here correspond to the frequency of surface acoustic wave in a sphere. So now in silica fiber, so this is a fabrication in my lab, so it's not really, really important. Just small point, we can down to 400 nanometer with a length of 80 millimeters and the loss is 1.2 dB. I have a small... It works? No, yes, maybe. Movie? No, it's a movie, but it's not important. So the setup to observe Brillouin scattering in nanofiber. This is the same as Brillouin speculum in chalcogenide, so just a bit between backscattering light and small part of the pump in electrical domain. What is interesting here, it's a direct measurement after the fabrication. We don't need to move the fiber, etc. So we obtain this speculum. So it's a really interesting speculum. So we have different resonances. So these resonances here coming from the untapered section of the fiber. So this measurement, it's like an integration all along the tapered optical fiber, the transition, the single mode fiber, etc., etc. Okay. So this is here the untapered section of the fiber. Here this is a resonance directly related to the small diameter of the taper. So the effective index change, okay, so it's around 8.5 GHz, and here we see two surface acoustic waves with lower frequency propagate at the surface of the macro wire. So here this is a longitudinal compression wave, and here this is a two surface acoustic wave. So just one calculation, so you see here clearly the compression wave, the elastic energy is maximum at the center, okay. And here, at the surface acoustic wave, the elastic energy is maximum in the border of silica rod. So, I will show you how it's possible to realize distributed measurement in this silica taper silica fiber. So, here to measure locally the Brillouin speculum, we use an interesting technique called correlation phase method. We use two pseudo-random phase modulation. So it's like laser here, phase modulator, and we inject in both directions, so in the pump and the probe. So here it's not CW wave and pulse wave, both pulse in phase, and at each correlation peak, we have a correlation peak here, and we can really create Brillouin interaction at this point along the fiber. So if we change, the length, if we make here some delay, we can map the Brillouin scattering all along the fiber. Okay, it's really different to basic system. As you remember, when we inject a CW laser and a pump pulse, so we have a laser, yeah. two parts, okay. One is to create pulse, okay. So it's pump, pump, pump pulse. And here it's a CW. We just create with electro-optical modulator. Okay, we have a pump here. And at the end, we just have two sideband in a Stokes and anti-Stokes frequency. Okay, we have this. We have our sample here. So here is not fiber, it's a taper. So like this, okay. And we just here use a circulator to detect Stokes or anti-Stokes waves, because here, when if we observe directly this line, we have, for example, this, not this, this, okay, and this one for Stokes and anti-Stokes. So if we didn't filter the Stokes or anti-Stokes, we didn't detect in oscilloscope the trace. It's a CW wave, okay. So we just find choose a good wave. So here, if you want to use this technique to separate optical fibers, it's impossible because the spatial resolution is directly related to the pump pulse duration. So for taper longer than, I don't know, 10 centimeters, if you want 10 points, we need a spatial resolution of 1 centimeter. So it's really small. And if you use a very small pulse, you have a very broadening spectrum, it's very, very difficult. So to avoid this, we didn't use intensity pulse, we use p-phase pulse. So it's an arbitrary, it's a pseudo-random phase modulation, both for pump and signal. And again, on signal, we shift the frequency. So the experiment is a little bit more complicating, but it's again the same system. The sample here, you have the pump here, and the signal here, and we also detect here. So again, the one laser, so we apply the phase modulator, so in the laser, and we split after the modulation. So here we create the pseudo-random bit seconds, okay. We modulate with amplitude modulator to create two sidebands, okay, so Stokes, anti-Stokes. Okay, so after we move the frequency to scan the different frequency between pump and the signal, we use here the polarization switch to take the two polarizations. So we make one measurement for one polarization and another one for other polarization. We make some operation to reduce the signal-to-noise ratio. Here we have an optical delay to change the position of the correlation peak along the fiber, and we change also the pseudo-random clock to resolve the signal. So with this technique, very difficult technique, it's again a collaboration with EPFL, we can obtain a spatial resolution of 10 millimeters. But with a very short sample, no longer than 10 meters, maybe, maximum. So this is here the simulation, okay? So this is a taper, and I just calculate the Brillouin spectrum at different position along the taper. So as you remember, the previous measurement, so heterodyne detection, it's an integration of all trace, okay, here, and we observe different resonance. Here the idea is to observe locally the different point. So it works. We detect here, so we scan during the experiment between 11 to 11.5. We scan at different position, so it's a long measurement. This measurement is around 2 hours, but we see these resonances here localized here, 0, it's the middle of the taper. Okay. Again, here it's more complicating, but it's a higher elastic resonance, so we see different resonance. We see clearly the taper. The taper is here, and here this is a 2 transition, so high frequency. Here again, this is a transition, so the resonance is coming from here. Here it's a elastic resonant inside the taper. You see it's localized to 0, okay? And the again this one, and the most interesting is this point. This is okay, small, okay, but this is a surface acoustic wave in the taper. So this experiment shows that it's possible to transfer energy by using surface acoustic wave in taper. Okay, this is really important for the future of this work. So you see it, okay, it's really small as compared to a compression elastic wave. You see here the noise, okay, really really low, really good signal to noise ratio. Sorry. And for surface acoustic wave, it's not so easy. So another idea with a macro wire, it's okay, it's nice, we taper the fiber, but if you taper and to obtain a very small diameter, how to find the diameter of the taper? Okay, one idea is to use a macroscopic image. So after the fabrication, you go to other lab, you make some manipulation, maybe some break. It's a really nice picture, but it's too long. Another idea is to use, for example, interference measurement. You have a laser here, you have a fiber here, and you inject light, and you can create an interference, and with this interference you can find the diameter of the macro wire. It's not so easy for us to realize this experiment. The idea is to use Brillouin scattering, because normally Brillouin spectrum depends on the diameter of the silica rod. This is the simulation. You see here the Brillouin spectrum as a function of diameter, and you see the Brillouin spectrum is different as a function of diameter. So normally if you just obtain the Brillouin spectrum, you can normally find what is the diameter of the taper. So we have different branches. So it's equivalent to a diagram dispersion, but okay, so we see the pressure branch, you see the shear branch, etc. So this is a different sensibility of different branch as a function of optical macro wire diameter. Okay, for small diameter, this resonances here is more sensitive than this one, for example. It's normal. So about the calculation, so this is the profile. Here is just a zoom of this section. We calculate again the Brillouin spectrum at different position. Okay, and we integrate. So this is the same picture. Okay, so single mode fiber, we taper, so this is a transition, and this is a homogeneous section, so this is a contribution of transition. This is just an integration. Okay, here this is an integration of all resonances. Okay, we make a sum in MATLAB in this case, and we obtain this spectrum. So now in experiment we have this spectrum, so with different resonances, and we can isolate the different resonance coming from different part of the fiber. So here of course it's single mode five fibers, the transition coming from here, and here the different line coming from this section. And now we just superpose experiment and simulation. So this is a macroscopic image. We just calculate the Brillouin spectrum for this diameter. We have a little bit difference here. So for us, real diameter it's 800 nanometer. The agreement is better, it's different zoom at different frequency. So the black it's experimental measurement, the green it's a diameter from a macroscopic image, and the blue it's a diameter from our model. So we have a very good agreement, especially here for example we didn't see any resonances. So we have a very good tools to estimate, to measure the diameter of tapered optical fibers. We can also estimate the homogeneity of the taper. So this is here an example experiment for 1.257 micrometer diameter with no fluctuation, and we just applied in the calculation some fluctuation along the taper. So of course the Brillouin spectrum is broadening, so 1%, 2%, 3%, 5%, we see that the best result is for 2. You see, for 2%, this resonance is perfectly fit. So we see now that the diameter is 1.25 with a homogeneity of 2%. So it's a really interesting tools we can make. So this is here different measurement for different diameter. In blue, this is a calculation. In white, this is a measurement. We have a good agreement. Okay. The main limitation of this technique is the diameter measurement, because for large diameter, the Brillouin resonance is inside the Brillouin resonance of single mode fibers. So we cannot measure diameter larger than 3 micrometers. But okay, it's not a big problem. Just very rapidly, what is interesting to working with Brillouin scattering and tapered optical fiber. Recently, we fabricated this box, so it's an hermetic box. We put some liquid, and the idea is to see the effect of liquid on a Brillouin spectrum. So in green, this is a Brillouin spectrum in air. So this is a standard fiber, just a connection between this box and the measurement. And in blue, this is a Brillouin spectrum in ethanol. So we put some ethanol here with a microwire, and we see some shift. So what it interesting? So it's a large diameter, it's not very small. And we use ethanol because, again, we're working at telecommunication wavelengths, and the idea is to move to 800 nanometers by using second harmonic generation and to working with different liquid. So the land width, you see here the difference between air and ethanol, the shift, and also the efficiency are directly related to the property of the cladding, so liquid, gas, etc. So to conclude, I will present you different class of optical fiber, standard single mode fiber. So this is a Brillouin spectrum, and this standard single mode fiber. Photonic crystal fiber, very broadening spectrum, and also tapered optical fibers. With standard single mode fiber, you can also suppress for high power fiber laser or enhance Brillouin scattering for distributed fiber sensor. In photonic crystal fiber, it's a very interesting sample to understand the phonon-photon interaction as a function of the hair hole macrostructure. And in tapered optical fiber, we observe new interaction, surface acoustic wave, Brillouin scattering, some hybrid acoustic wave, so it's a mix between compression acoustic wave and shear acoustic wave. And it's really interesting to also to manipulate the light and the sound at the nanoscale. So this is the end, I think. Yeah, it's just some perspective, maybe a little bit different to fiber. It's new waveguide, actually many groups working on Brillouin scattering, but not in fibers, but in optical waveguide. So in chalcogenide waveguide, it's a group in Kudos in Australia. Also in silicon nitride, so you see it's really high frequency. I don't know why is it the frequency, maybe here, normalized frequency. So here you see the waveguide is suspended by this pedestal. It's a really difficult experiment, but very promising measurement. The idea is to realize a laser, Brillouin laser. And that's it. I will just thanks different collaborators, InFEM2ST, INIPFL, FLAM, McGill, Institute Optique, different company, and also the financial support. Thank you very much for your attention. Open to discussion. No, not in standard single mode fiber. It's possible in high power fiber laser, different person see some thermal effect. And we observe thermal effect, but in tapered optical fibers, because we reduce the diameter, we increase the confinement of the light. Imagine in tapered optical fibers, here we can inject sometimes 1 CW watt in the piece of 500 nanometers. So we see some thermal effect. We don't know exactly the origin or how it create, but yeah, we have some thermal effect, but not in standard single mode fibers. Yes. I don't know, but I think it's possible, yeah. Yes.
You said it was by Rayleigh scattering, right?
Yes.
So that is the low intensity value, and if you have high intensity, then Brillouin scattering limits, or it gives the main loss mechanism?
No. So the main loss process is a Rayleigh scattering. A Rayleigh is a linear process. It's just purity of the glass,
yes,
during the fabrication. If you arrive at Brillouin threshold, of course the losses is really higher, but we have a pump depletion. It's not linear regime, so it's equivalent to a Brillouin laser. So it's not a good region for data transmission.
Okay, but did I understand well that suppose you have a 1 kilometer fiber, you have,
yes,
0.2 dB loss.
Yes. Yes.
And if I would send just very few photons through it,
yeah,
this would be the limit. But if I increase it to 1 milliwatt, then I would already get attenuation much earlier because of the nonlinear interaction with.
No, just the Brillouin scattering just limit the maximum power. So in the transmission, you have a saturation of the power, and just the Brillouin scattering reflect some light. If you have a
either it's Rayleigh scattering or reflection.
Yeah, if you have long fibers, okay, you measure the transmission. You have like this. So here it's directly the losses. Okay, it's a Rayleigh reflection. Okay, so if you measure here the reflection, we inject a light. Okay, so this is a reflection, and at this point, you have a saturation of the transmission. Okay, so you cannot increase. If you increase again the power, you want to put 10 watt or something, you saturate, and all the injected power is reflected. So you have a large reflected power. So all person working with 5 fiber stop before this line. Nobody working on a saturation. Yeah, no. Oh, it's when Brillouin scattering, because just you have a spool, you inject a light, you increase the power, and so it's a spontaneous Brillouin effect. But when you increase the power, you remember the circle of the phenomenon. You inject too many powers, and you create a very strong acoustic wave. It's equivalent to a Bragg ratings, and at this moment, so at this power, the light is reflected. And that's it. Why at this power, just a definition, we don't know exactly why. Yes. It's a two family of surface acoustic wave. One is torso-radial, another one is radial. It's not the same. It's not always in all diameters, depends of the diameters, but we have two different families of this surface acoustic wave.
And it seems
Yes. Yes, because it's not the perfect diameter to observe this. Yes. 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 Yeah. And we observe recently that we really decrease the diameter of the taper, so around 500 nanometers, the compression wave disappear. We didn't see, we have just surface acoustic wave. We don't know exactly why, but we observe this. So it's interesting. Yes, yeah. Yes, long mode or something like that, yeah. Yeah, long. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. We observe more relay for more larger rod. Yeah. So make of yeah. We're specialist of acoustic, I see. Yes, it's symmetric or not symmetric. Yes? The strain amplitude of the variation of the refractive index, it's around 10 over minus 12, the variation of the refractive index induced by Brillouin scattering. It's really, really small.
Is there a refractive index?
Yeah, which is... Yes, yeah. Yes? The idea at the start is just to detect liquid. That's it, just just property liquid. And so telecommunication wavelength is not adapt for this. And the idea is just to move to other wavelengths, like in 800 nanometers. And this is probably the most interesting, is to convert high coherence fiber laser telecommunication by second harmonic generation in 800 nanometers. Brillouin measurement is liquid, it's just nice measurement, and it's not the main claim of this work. Yeah, because we when we send a paper to Nature, the reviewer said, okay, this is just spontaneous measurement, it's impossible to realize gain, to transfer in energy by using this surface acoustic wave. Like a gobs, it's just a noise in a fiber, it's not important. So we say, okay, no, it's important, we would like to demonstrate it's possible to realize energy transfer. It's only this motivation. Sorry, I don't. Can you repeat, please?
Have you ever taken into account another mechanism, photoelastic mechanism, which could change your detection?
We would like, not yet, but we would like to add some different effect. We would like also to working at low pressure in vacuum. We'd like to maybe. One perspective is to mix Brillouin scattering and optomechanics. Maybe Ivan Favero last week present some link between Brillouin and optomechanics. I don't know, but he working on that, because on different sample, the optomechanics frequency and Brillouin frequency are really close, and the idea is to see how it's possible to mix, to enhance, to suppress. Some people say it's just addition. Some people say no, it's just a subtraction. So this is interesting. Okay. Okay, thank you very much.